What's up, y'all? It's Celeste, and before I get into the actual content of this video, real quick, I just want to show you this awesome t-shirt that I got from The Change Project, which is an organization that helps LGBTQ communities around the South and Midwest United States. And they have an online store called Shop Progress, where I got this t-shirt. They also have a bunch of other stuff, which I'll be flashing up on the screen here. And the proceeds from these sales goes to help the organization. So if you are interested in getting any of this cool stuff, you can actually get a 10% discount by using my code, which I will be putting up on the screen here, as well as in the description below. So definitely go check that out because their clothing is awesome. And of course, also it benefits the community. So what could be better than that? So now for what you actually came to this video to hear about. I'm gonna give a little bit of background here and I'm gonna explain it more in just a second, but real quick, I'm gonna give sort of a brief timeline of my medical hormone intervention that I've had for this past year. Earlier this year, for 3 months, I took low-dose T, which is testosterone, and then I stopped that, and shortly after that, I started taking spironolactone, which is an anti-androgen. Then I stopped taking that. And so it's now been exactly 6 months since my last T-shot. It's been just about 3 weeks since my last spironolactone dose. But before that, I was going down on my dose for a month. So it's been about 7 weeks since I started going down on my spironolactone dose. So like I said, earlier this year, I took low-dose T, which was 25 milligrams a week, for 3 months. It was actually like 3 months and a week. My intent with taking T was always to take it temporarily because there are some effects of tea that are permanent that just happen from your body sort of being flooded with testosterone. And then there are other things that your body depends on an ongoing elevated level of testosterone to maintain. One of the permanent changes is when your voice drops, that's permanent because it actually changes the shape of your vocal cords. Another change that's permanent is facial and body hair growth. Now, both of these things can slightly revert when you stop taking tea because there is a little bit of the maintenance kind of level of testosterone that those things kind of depend on. But for the most part, pretty much if you stop taking tea, you're not gonna go back to how you were before tea in those two areas, especially with the voice. With the hair, without an ongoing level of tea, then your hair might actually kind of thin out and soften and lighten, but you're not going to go back to being just like totally smooth skinned, like whatever level of smooth skin you were before starting tea. There are other effects of taking tea that require an ongoing dose, which I would have liked to have, like facial structure and body fat and muscle redistribution. Those would be nice, but you have to be on tea for an ongoing period and pretty much like maintain taking tea for those things to stick around. And I wasn't on tea for really long enough for either of those things to really change a lot. I did have a slight facial restructuring kind of thing, but I didn't really get the effects of that too much. And again, because I was only taking it temporarily, I couldn't really count on either of those things sticking around for too long. But the voice drop was the thing that I wanted the most. It was the main reason I wanted to take tea. And my voice did drop a tiny bit and it got a little bit fuller. So it did change. It did not change quite to the level that I wanted it to, but I also started to get facial and body hair, which I really did not want. And so when I started taking tea, I always knew that it would be kind of a race to see which of those things would happen first. And I was hoping that my voice would drop significantly enough before that the hair started coming in that I would be happy with my voice. Unfortunately, the hair started to come in before I was really satisfied with the level my voice had dropped to, but I always knew that was a risk, and I still am glad that I took tea. I don't regret it at all. But I did start to get hair coming in, so I stopped taking tea. For 3 weeks after my last tea dose, I continued to notice a little bit of hair coming in, like hair that wasn't there the previous 3 weeks. And so I decided to start taking spironolactone again. That's something that I had previously taken for acne. What spironolactone is actually a blood pressure medication. That was what it was originally designed to do, but it has anti-androgen properties. So in AFAB people, it is commonly used for acne because a lot of times acne flare-ups are caused by elevated levels of testosterone. In AMAP people, it is also used for transition because it does not elevate your estrogen levels, but it does decrease your testosterone levels. It suppresses them. So it affects the aspects of testosterone that I was talking about that depend on that ongoing elevated testosterone level. It doesn't change back the things that happened when the body like originally got this flood of testosterone in the first place, but it does lower the levels that are kind of ongoing, so it can affect certain things. One of those things is it doesn't reverse hair growth, but like I said, it can make the hair lighten and thin out in some areas. So I was originally prescribed spironolactone for acne. I have taken it on and off for I don't even know how long. I would say at least 15 years. It might be longer than that. I can't remember if I was in high school or college when I first started taking it. I kind of think I was in high school, so that was a long time ago. But I've been taking it off and on since then. I stopped taking it before I started taking testosterone, obviously, because it would be kind of pointless to take an anti-androgen at the same time as you're taking testosterone. So I was off of it, and then once I stopped taking testosterone, I decided to go back on it because I really wanted to kind of just halt everything. It obviously takes a while for your body to kind of go back to like its normal levels. So in order to kind of hasten that process and get my levels down to their natural levels as quickly as possible, I decided to start taking spironolactone again. I originally planned to take it for like maybe a month and then go back to just taking nothing and kind of just seeing what my body did with its natural hormone levels without any kind of intervention one way or the other, but it actually ended up being more like 4 months. So all of the changes that my body has had or that I've noticed in myself since being off of T, particularly the things that kind of reverted back to where I was before I started taking T or kind of in that direction, I couldn't really be sure if those things were from not taking tea anymore or from being on the spironolactone because, like I said, it lowers your natural testosterone levels, so it actually, it's not the same as just stopping taking extra testosterone. It's like actually lowering my natural testosterone levels. But I finally decided to stop taking it because I wanted to see what I would be like without it, and also, as I mentioned in a couple videos ago, a video called Transition Envy, which I'll link above, I have been considering taking tea again, even though I really don't want any more hair growth, but I do want my voice to drop a little bit more, so I haven't decided yet one way or the other, but it's just something I've been thinking about, and so again, obviously I need to stop taking spironolactone and like get my own levels back to their natural levels before I start taking testosterone because, again, that would be kind of pointless. So I decided to stop taking it, and then that way, after like a month or two, I can sort of revisit and decide what I'm going to do. So at the very beginning of November is when I started decreasing my spironolactone dose. I don't generally like to just quit medications cold turkey unless I'm having like some major reaction that I need to like get off the medication completely, but I prefer to do it kind of over a somewhat gradual period. So in this case, it was over the course of a month. Even though I wasn't off of it completely, just from decreasing my dose, I pretty quickly started to notice some things happening. One of those things was that I did get some acne flare-ups, and I'm not wearing any makeup right now, but, you know, this light does kind of wash out my skin a little bit, so I don't know if you can actually see, but I do have a little bit of flare-up on my face, but I also, on my chest and a little bit on my back, also have some flare-ups. But the biggest thing I noticed was that I did start to get some hair back in areas where it had kind of disappeared over the last few months, and when it kind of disappeared, I wasn't entirely sure if I was like imagining it, if maybe like, I don't know, maybe I just gotten used to it or I don't know. I guess I didn't really think about it that much. I've been really busy the last few months and with top surgery and everything like that. So I wasn't like examining myself really closely, but I had kind of gotten used to not seeing as much hair, I guess, again. And so when I stopped taking the spironolactone, it started to come back in certain areas. The first place I actually noticed it was on my chest because I've been taking all these like close-up shots of my chest after top surgery, and the first several that I did, I didn't have any like big amount of noticeable hair. I mean, there was a little bit, but you had to look pretty closely to see it. It's still not like a huge amount or anything. Like the hair on my entire body isn't like a huge amount, but I was getting it A, in places that I did not have really any noticeable hair at all before, and B, it was getting a little bit thicker and a little bit darker in some areas. And again, it was still like not a huge amount, but it was clearly going in a direction where it would be eventually, because given my genetics, I'm pretty sure I would end up really hairy if I took testosterone ongoing, because my dad's pretty hairy. So I really don't want to kind of go down that road any farther than I have to. So even though it looks like I don't have a whole lot of hair, like just the fact that it was going in that direction is what made me want to stop it there and not allow it to get any farther than I would feel comfortable having. So anyway, I did notice some hair on my chest a little bit. Also kind of going down my stomach in the center of it, like basically what some people call a happy trail. I've definitely noticed some of that coming back. And it's also come back on the tops of my feet. And all of these places were places that I had noticed hair coming in when I was on tea, and like in the couple weeks after I stopped taking tea, those were the areas that I was starting to notice it. And then it kind of went away and I kind of forgot about it. And then when it started coming back, I realized that though that hair was like a permanent change from taking testosterone, and it's just the fact that I was on spironolactone that suppressed my T levels enough that it kind of went back away. So I wanted to make this video because I had already made a video when I stopped taking tea. I made a six weeks off tea video, which again, I will link above, that I talked about some of these somewhat more immediate changes that I noticed being off of tea. But now it's been 6 months since I've been off tea, and I also have had this extra variable of spironolactone, which I was aware of at the time I made the 6 week video. I actually mentioned it in that, but I had no way of knowing what it was affecting because I was taking it, so I didn't have any control group, obviously, because it's just me. So now I've been off of my full dose for 7 weeks, and I've noticed all these changes coming back. So I wanted to make this video to update y'all and give you some more information about my experience as it's been kind of ongoing. And I don't know how super relevant this will be to everybody, because obviously not that many people probably take spironolactone. It's also probably pretty unusual for people to take both testosterone and spironolactone, because like I said, spironolactone is usually used for transitioning, like, to feminize the body, and testosterone is used to masculinize the body. So it kind of is weird to take them both. And I'm sure somebody's gonna watch this video and, like, interpret that as me detransitioning by taking spironolactone, but that's not what's happening. It really has nothing to do with that. It's just the fact that I don't want facial or body hair, and that's not really an uncommon thing to not want. Like, I know plenty of cis guys who don't want facial or body hair either. That's not to say that they necessarily like actually go out and get like a full body wax or anything, but I've talked to cis guys who don't like having their as much body hair as they do. It's just annoying and hot and, you know, itchy and stuff. And then I know a lot of guys who shave every day, and it just seems like a big pain to me. So I don't want to deal with that. I've also had several comments, like pretty much every time I make a video where I talk about not wanting facial or body hair, I get comments, and these are like super well-meaning comments. So in no way am I like criticizing people for saying this, but I get a lot of people suggesting that I just go ahead and take tea until I'm happy with my voice and then stop and then just get laser hair treatment to deal with the hair. There are two reasons why that's not really practical. One is the fact that laser hair treatment is really expensive. It costs like hundreds of dollars for getting like an area laser treated. It takes like several treatments over the course of several months, and it costs hundreds of dollars. I mean, you can get like Groupon deals and stuff like that, but essentially it's really expensive. So I can't just like go out and do that. The other thing is that, like I said, I have noticed hair like on my entire body pretty much. So it's not just my face that I'm concerned about. I don't want to have all this extra hair all over my whole body, and it's not practical for me to get laser hair treatment on, again, like my entire body. Even if like I became super rich and could afford it, it seems kind of impractical to me. I would probably do it if I had like millions of dollars, but it wouldn't be like the ideal solution. It's not like something you can just like, oh, well, I'll just get laser hair treatment. Like, it's nothing. It's kind of a big deal to get done. So again, I really appreciate the suggestions, because I know the people who have said that, like, you're trying to be helpful, but at least in my situation, I don't feel like that would really be a practical solution. So anyway, now that I have been off of spironolactone, in addition to the acne and the hair things, and acne might actually kind of level out over time. I don't know. It might be just flaring up because the hormones have been kind of messed with, and so it's trying to like get back to normal. I don't know. But the other thing is that I kind of forgot how much more of a pain my menstrual cycle is when I'm not taking spironolactone. It actually makes that lighter and shorter, and I had been taking spironolactone for so long, and then when I was on tea and I wasn't taking spironolactone, like, I didn't have any menstrual cycle for most of that time. So that was awesome. I wish I could get back to that. So I'm kind of feeling like maybe I want to go back on spironolactone kind of indefinitely, but again, I'm waiting to see what I decide about tea. If I start taking tea again, I will do that and then probably go back on spironolactone. And I don't know, I kind of feel like if I got a little bit of extra hair from taking tea again, that would be okay, because I'm already having to kind of manage the amount that I've gotten. And so if I got like a little bit more in those areas that I could deal with the same way, then that wouldn't be that big of a deal. And then also the fact that apparently by taking spironolactone, I can kind of thin out and lighten some of the hair that I get from tea. That's good to know. So I don't know, I really haven't decided yet what I'm going to do about that. But I do feel like I have more information to go on now that I know the effect that the spironolactone variable has on that. But hopefully this was at least informative to, like, even if you aren't yourself on spironolactone, or I don't know, like, even if this isn't going to be your actual experience, like your particular experience, maybe it's helpful or informative somehow to just let you know, like, just give you like a real world example of how these different forms of affecting hormone levels can affect somebody. But as always, you can leave comments or questions in the comment section below, and give this video a thumbs up if you liked it, and subscribe to see more of my future content. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.